Kia ora koutou. My name is Rachel Major and I'm 17 years old. I'm a Year 12 student at Waikato Diocesan School for Girls in Hamilton. My dad had a brain tumour and he died at the age of 42. He could have died when I was 1 or 4. He was under hospice and looked like he was dying, but he didn't die naturally until I was 9, so I knew him. I want to give you 5 reasons I've come to Wellington in the middle of exams to talk to MPs about the final end-of-life choice bill MPs are voting on today. The first reason is that the bill is based on the myth that doctors always get it right when it comes to prognosis. I'm glad the doctors were wrong in Dad's case, but they couldn't help it. He really was dying at different times in my life. I'm glad euthanasia wasn't available to my dad because he was eligible a lot of the time. And someone with a terminal illness is vulnerable to feeling like a burden to the people around them. In Oregon, 63% of people give the reason of feeling a burden for requesting lethal drugs, and only 31% give the reason of pain or concern about pain. For some strange reason, adults don't think children are as resilient as we are. We would rather have a sick parent than no parent. My dad had significant disabilities and cancer and damage to his brain from radiotherapy all my life until he died, but I had a pretty good childhood, all things considered. I just found out I am head girl next year at my school. Although my dad couldn't be there for my opening speech, if it wasn't for him, I probably wouldn't have been standing on that stage. A lot of that had to do with the way he fought to live. No matter how bad it got, he never gave up until his last breath. Had he got assistance to die, that would have been his decision, and I would have really struggled with that. The second reason is that there is no mention of support for mental health or the bereaved in the final bill. If the doctor thinks you have undiagnosed depression, it doesn't say that he or she has to offer any support for your mental health, even though you went to the doctor wanting to die. Sick parents don't have to tell their children they are going to ask for euthanasia. They don't even have to tell their partner. No one has to tell anyone that they are thinking about premature death. The bill says people are encouraged to tell their family and friends. But why would you want to tell the people who want you to live that you want to die? The first they may know of your decision is that you've died and they've had no chance of trying to support you to live and die naturally. That would cause so much trauma for the loved ones left behind. Who would look after the children who had sick parents that opted for euthanasia and weren't part of the decision? It could cause serious mental health problems and PTSD. Would the new suicide prevention office support children whose sick parents assisted death would be deemed okay by society? The third reason is that the youngest age you can request euthanasia is still 18. It is a well-known fact that the human brain isn't fully developed until 25 years of age, and more specifically, the prefrontal cortex, which is responsible for decision-making. So why is 18, 7 years before brains are fully developed, the age when you can make the most important decision of your life, to fight to live or to die prematurely? We are too young to know what we can cope with, and we already have heaps of irrational fear in our lives. We are teenagers. If we didn't have to tell our parents we were going to the doctor about euthanasia, we wouldn't. The fourth reason is that no one is checking this right through. If something goes wrong, there is no justice. The key witness is dead. No other witnesses are required at any point in the process. The registrar and review committee cannot verify that any information on a form reflects what really happened. Nobody would be responsible for reviewing all the forms pertaining to a particular case. The fifth and final reason is that the final bill still hasn't been made safe. Only the first doctor has to check for coercion. Your abuser could be out of sight but still in the room while you video call the doctor. Your family don't need to know. The people you've left behind won't receive any support, and you weren't given enough support to die naturally. And that's why this is an irremediable bill with irreversible fatal consequences. So my 5 points in summary are: your prognosis might be wrong, there's no support for mental health or the people left behind, 18 is too young to know what you can endure, No one is checking this right through, and the final bill has not been made safe. Thank you.